In another video, I went through over 100 job descriptions on LinkedIn to find the 7 most in-demand skills for DevOps engineers. I want to complement that video by giving to you the advice that I'd wish I'd received before starting a career in DevOps. My name is Jarrett Coggan, and I'm a staff DevOps engineer with over a decade of experience. I have interviewed many people for DevOps engineering positions, both as my fellow colleagues and people that would report to me. I want to cover the mindset shifts that I believe every engineer needs to make in order to succeed with a long-term career in DevOps. Let's get started. I'm going to talk about my life and my career a fair bit in this video because I'd rather talk from a place of real world experience rather than giving you generic advice. What I did worked for me, and it may or may not work for you. This advice might need tweaks here and there, and for some situations, you might need to come up with your own approach from scratch. Let's get started with what is the most important mindset you will need in order to have success in any career, let alone a career in DevOps. No one cares about your career more than you do. You must own your career, your skills development, and your experience. With DevOps in particular, you will often be encountering new tools and technologies you haven't worked with before. So getting comfortable digging into the unknown and developing those skills is crucial for long-term success. At one point while I was working for Twitch, I realized I wasn't happy with my job and took stock of my career and my life. I didn't feel I was working on developing skills that would help me grow long-term and move up the corporate ladder. This was actually a really sobering experience. I realized that I had been trying to use my day job to actively grow my skills and my career when I should have been using my day job to focus on delivering value for a company. I also realized that at 4 separate companies, I'd wanted to develop hands-on experience with tools like Ansible, Terraform, and Kubernetes, and it just wasn't happening. At each of those companies, I'd explain my rationale to my manager and include areas that I thought it would be great to apply the tool in. And I'd always get a response along the line of, that sounds great, but we need to focus on the projects we are trying to deliver now, maybe next year. This answer pissed me off. But in hindsight, each of my managers was probably doing what they believed was best for the team and the company. They were trying to make sure that they were keeping each team member on task and delivering against the projects that they agreed to. Each of those managers was doing their best to succeed in ways they thought would be best for their lives, whether that's keeping a steady job, moving up the ladder in their own way, or whatever else it was that motivated them. I also reflected on the fact that anytime I had to interview for positions at other companies that wanted or required these skills that I wanted to have, I often wouldn't make it past the technical screen. And when I would, it never resulted in job offer. Every rejection letter stated that they were going with a more qualified candidate, and that really hurt to hear. I eventually said that enough was enough, and that I was tired of my career not heading in the direction that I wanted to go in. I made a commitment to myself that I was going to take matters into my own hands. I was going to get very applicable, concrete, hands-on experience using AWS, Terraform, Docker, and Kubernetes. I said that I didn't care what I had to do to further my experience in a meaningful, measurable way, and that I was going to do it come hell or high water. I made a promise to myself that I'd be truly responsible for my career and that I'd do whatever it took to own my career. So I decided to work on my skills development outside of my job. This was truly empowering and energizing and felt very exciting. I asked myself what I thought would be a good project to do that with, that would develop my skills with AWS, Terraform, Docker, and Kubernetes, that I could show off to other engineers and employers. I came up with a list of ideas for projects that I was excited about and sketched out a plan for one of them. For the project I came up with, I had to leave Twitch to work on it. But once I did, I'd relentlessly attack that project with all of my excitement and energy. So I decided to leave Twitch and mentally/emotionally checked out and started looking for a new job. At the same time, my performance had already been suffering for long enough that my manager decided to put me on a performance improvement plan, otherwise known as a PIP. I decided I didn't want to do the PIP, so we agreed on a severance package and I left the company. I cannot possibly explain how good it felt to leave a job that was actively draining my energy while also having a concrete direction and a plan of action for the future. Even though I didn't have a job lined up and knew that I have to work for another company relatively soon, I knew I'd be okay. Even though I got a new job about 6 weeks later, I spent the next 2 years during my nights and weekends relentlessly working on that project and building those skills with AWS, Terraform, Docker, and Kubernetes, in addition to other skills. At the end of that period, when I felt like I had truly accomplished everything I wanted to accomplish with that project, I took stock of that project and added it to my resume. When I landed my next job where the requirements listed must have experience with AWS, Terraform, Docker, and Kubernetes, Kubernetes, I felt ecstatic. Honestly, the interviews felt a whole lot easier than before. One of the interviewers said that it was so blatantly obvious that I had put Terraform into practice compared to a number of other candidates. It made it a no-brainer to offer me the role. To summarize this point, don't look for permission from others to get the experience that you want. Identify ways to develop those skills on your own and develop a concrete plan of action to earn that experience. It will probably involve you getting outside of your comfort zone, but I assure you, it will pay dividends. As the saying goes, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. Since I've tried on this mindset and initially saw such great success, I've done everything I can to maintain this attitude towards my entire career. It's paid dividends because I've tackled problems I never thought I'd get a chance to. I've found new ways to stretch my abilities, and I've started to see my role in companies in a new light. The next mindset shift is to look for opportunities to tie yourself to the success of the business in a concrete manner and do everything you can to knock those opportunities out of the park. At one of the smaller companies I've worked at, we had a key engineer leave the company who had essentially single-handedly built a project from the technical side that was a new product and a new line of revenue. That new product was a huge opportunity for the company, and over the course of an entire year, led to 6 or 7 times the return on investment. After the engineer left, no one knew how to maintain the product since no other engineers worked on it. Our sales team saw this as a huge risk and stopped offering it to new or existing customers. The customer who had originally asked for this product stopped using it after the engineer left and ultimately stopped being our customer altogether a few months later. Once that customer left, we tore down that infrastructure for that product to save money. That was very hard emotionally for a lot of people at the company because so many people had invested time and energy into getting that product out the door and seeing success with it, only to tear it down less than a year later. Everyone felt like the company took a huge hit when that project was torn down. Something about that customer leaving pissed me off, so I looked into what it would take to resurrect that product. Over the course of a week, I learned everything I could about that product when I wasn't working on more urgent tasks. I found out what it would take to stand the product back up from a technical aspect and identified gaps in the product's capabilities. I worked with sales and product management to define a fair price for the product that would help boost our bottom line. We worked together to identify a quick opportunity to showcase the product and reached out to customers who might benefit from it. This reinvigorated the team and it felt like we were back on the offensive. This led to me being brought into conversations with sales and customers, in addition to having more conversations with our CEO and our CFO. I identified a number of opportunities where we could add specific features and raise prices or clean up tech debt, optimize our engineering stack, and cut costs. As time went on, I was seen as a must-retain employee in the company and was given a much bigger equity package as a result. Bringing this back around to more of a DevOps focus, consider ways you can improve the effectiveness of your team and other teams. If you have 6 different ways to deploy and host applications, can you simplify that approach and leverage economies of scale? For example, if you are currently deploying applications on virtual machines, containers, bare metal servers, and as serverless functions, can you reduce the number of approaches to hosting these applications and put most or all of your applications on that one approach? Can you implement this strategy across teams within your organization so that when you implement a new tool or technology for one team, all teams can benefit? Can you identify contracts that you are spending too much money on and find more cost-effective solutions or renegotiate the contract? If you're paying $50,000 a year on a piece of enterprise software and only using the features found in the open source version of that software, can you host that software yourself and eliminate the need for that contract? If you know you are going to use a piece of software long-term, can you move to an annual contract instead of month-to-month in exchange for a 30% discount? Can you find ways to reduce costs, such as deleting old files that no longer need to be kept around? In this case, I'm thinking of binaries that are generated for development branches that aren't shipped to production. A lot of the time, teams delete the development branch, but don't clean up the binaries that came from that branch. I've rarely seen a case where any of those binaries were used. So if you are eating up massive amounts of storage space, this could be an area that's prime for savings. The final mindset shift is to empower the team around you and others in your industry. I want to differentiate this from the previous example by focusing on 2 points: pushing the ball forward and leveling up others. Pushing the ball forward came from 2 points in my life. The first point, and the name itself, came from whenever I was a kid. I remember one of the American football coaches that taught at my high school talking about the 2 things that a player who is running the football down the field should always be doing. They should never stop moving their legs and driving down the field. And at the point when they know they are tackled and going down, they should push the ball forward to try and gain extra yardage. Everything you can do to push that ball further down the field makes it easier to score points. Even an extra yard or two puts you that much closer to scoring a touchdown or making a field goal easier, making you more likely to win the game. The second time, and probably a little more applicable to this audience, was when I worked with a principal engineer who had a daily habit of starting off by unblocking the company and the team. Every day, he would go through his list of priorities, which were in this order: fix production, push the release, fix the build, review others' code, review others' designs, move your work forward. When I read through this list, it seemed counterintuitive and at the same time made complete sense. It seemed counterintuitive because I wondered how I was going to get my work done when it was the least important thing on that list. At the same time, I realized that he had a habit of pushing the ball forward. If production is down, we can't make money. So we need to make sure production is always up. If a release needs to go out the door, then we can potentially improve our bottom line by being more competitive in the market, whether that's new features, bug fixes, or cost optimizations. If the build is broken, we can't get anything out the door. So productivity for the entire team, org, or even company grinds to a halt. If other team members are waiting for code reviews from me, they can't ship their features, which slows down the company and slowly makes the company less competitive over time. If other team members are waiting for design reviews and feedback from me, then they can't push new projects or other important work forward, so I'm actively holding up their work. When I finally get around to moving my work forward, the last thing I want is to be blocked by others. Ultimately, if my entire team can adopt this mindset, none of us should ever be blocked on our most important work. And if we are blocked, it shouldn't be for long. These six steps were the embodiment of pushing the ball forward for a technical team. Pushing the ball forward doesn't just apply to engineering work, but to every task you take on in life. When you are about to wrap up for the day, take a few minutes to plan the next time you are going to work so that you can get started more quickly. Can you leave yourself a note for what you could start on first to get going quickly? Can you write a little more context in your next project update email, identifying the next action items, who should take them on, when they should be reported on, and how everyone should be updated? Can you add one more automated test to make that code a little less fragile next time somebody works on it? One of the other crucial things that this principal engineer did was document this and share it with the team, which brings me to the other point: level up others. This principal engineer had a habit of documenting his work, sharing with others, and improving things as he went. Anytime he was on call, rather than using it as a passive opportunity to just respond to issues, he actively investigated the root causes of issues, documented the root cause, and put a plan of attack to address the root cause. Often he even worked on it. If he wasn't able to actually fix the root cause of issue when he was on call, he championed for that work to be included in the next sprint if possible. He actively took steps to make on-call better for the next engineer after him. When he was working on projects, he had long conversations with not just engineering team members, but other areas of the company to make sure he understood every team that was impacted by that project. When he wrote documentation, he didn't just document the project design. He also documented the design decisions, the scalability challenges, the security aspects, the sensitivity of the data the project would generate, the maintenance concerns, the tech debt introduced by decisions made to implement the project, and so much more. These were tomes for each of those projects. When someone else needed to work on that project, however, the principal engineer would point them at the documentation for them to read, and by the time the other person was done reading that, they'd have a very good grasp of the overall status of the project. The principal engineer set up other team members for success by decoupling their ramp-up time from his time investment of sharing knowledge. When the principal engineer left the company, it was seen as a huge loss because he was such a force multiplier for everyone he worked with. In my eyes, he was the definition of a 10x engineer. Even if you are just getting started in your career, you can still level up others by documenting solutions to problems that you've encountered. Even someone far more senior than you can find your solution incredibly valuable, especially if it's the first time they are working with that tool, technology, or in that problem space. If you want an example, see Stack Overflow. That's part of why I recorded this video in the first place. It's one of my attempts at leveling up others in the tech industry. If you found these tips helpful, like the video. If you want to hear more about what I have to say about AWS and DevOps, subscribe to the channel. Stick around for my next video. Until next time.